It's May 18, 2012. This is Justice Done Dirt Cheap. We are at their Justice building. And how are you doing today?
Oh, hi, Andre. Just came out of court. Chief?
Before we begin, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yes, I'm Evelyn Greene, as I had previously stated. What I would like to say up front before I go on any further is that I do not, my family, my siblings have nothing to do with my issues. I just want to make that clear. They're no part of what I'm doing. In fact, in some ways, I'm estranged from my family, and that's all I want to say from that, of my siblings anyway. And what they do in their lives, their political lives or whatever, has nothing to do with me, okay? And everybody grows up in a family, and some people are different, some people stick up for their rights, some people just don't. And some people have not experienced what I've experienced here in New Brunswick.
Yes.
But what I wanted to show was that I just came out of court before Judge Jackson, the chief provincial judge here in New Brunswick.
Yes.
He's the third judge on my bogus assault charges that the police laid against me at Ambulance New Brunswick. And I just want to point out that the police investigated themselves. In fact, they even had Constable Blanchette, one of the culprits, taking the evidence.
Yes.
Handling the evidence, okay?
Yes.
I came here to court today to go before the judge. I filed a motion in the court, which I talked about earlier, and I want to put it on your blog for people to read. I talked about the importance of disclosure. I talked about the importance of stitch comb. That was one of the most famous cases in Canada, decided by the Supreme Court. And next after that is O'Connor, R versus O'Connor. And the Supreme Court again said a person has to know the case against him or her, right?
Yes.
In order to defend themselves.
Yes.
Then there's the McNeil reports. You were beaten up by Nancy Rideout, a police constable who beat me up, and they didn't give me any McNeil reports or any other reports. Then there's been evidence given from David Banks to Constable Estee that is questionable, because Constable Estee said he gave it to the Crown Prosecutor, Christopher Levine, but Christopher Levine says he didn't have it.
Yes.
So Christopher Levine went directly to the police sometime in February, March, and asked for it again.
Yes.
And as I said earlier, I had a very well-known company in Ontario known as NCI, who are experts in the field of looking at intelligence, especially CCTV cameras.
Yes.
Now, I 2 weeks ago, I phoned Lucy Sutherland, who works for Judge Jackson in Woodstock. She's his assistant. And the judge wasn't there at the moment, so she said, I'm going to ask Assistant Deputy Pierre Arsenault. He's a judge in Moncton. She got back to me and she said, Judge Arsenault said for you, Ms. Green, to get your motion, your affidavit, and your exhibits in as soon as possible. So the next day I was down here. I had Mr. Bray, the registrar, commission them for me. And I filed them into the court, okay, into the provincial court.
Yes.
And the clerk down here in the provincial court, the head clerk, her name is Catherine Wilson.
Yes.
And she said to me, Judge Jackson has been waiting for your application. Okay?
Yes.
So anyway, I hate getting interrupted.
Yes.
I think that was deliberate. They never do that. Catherine said to me, he's been waiting for this, and she said, I will fax this up right away. That was on a Monday.
Yes.
On Wednesday, now this is over 2 weeks ago, on Wednesday I called Miss Sutherland, Judge Jackson's assistant.
Yes.
And I said, Judge, did he get the report? All of a sudden, believe it or not, Judge Jackson had gone on this long-winded holiday, and he wouldn't be back until the 11th.
Yes.
Of May. So I said to Miss Sutherland, I said, Judge Arsenault, Pierre Arsenault, told me to get it in right away, and it's now sitting on your desk, so who's going to look at it, because my trial date is on June the 11th. And she said she spoke to Judge Jackson, and he said that he is seized with this matter.
Yes.
And that he would deal with it when he came back on the 11th. Okay?
Yes.
And I had submitted 5 subpoenas. One was to Alan Stephen of Ambulance New Brunswick, and one was to their CCTV installation provider.
Yes.
Known as Atlantic Alarm and Sound Inc. in Dieppe.
Yes.
And the owner is Louis Bourgeois.
Yes.
Now in January, I called down to Louis Bourgeois' place and I got his service coordinator, Richard Parent.
Yes.
Who told me that there never was a problem with the cameras at 24 Harold Daugherty Court in Fredericton. The only time the technicians ever went there was for cleaning the cameras.
Yes.
Okay. So I didn't expect anything different because there's been so many lies and so many of this and that. It's just been awful.
Yes.
And as I said, Robin O'Hara, the manager that day at Ambulance New Brunswick, he was the one apparently who has the password, as does Paul Cormier, who is one of their persons down in Moncton. And so anyway, Ambulance New Brunswick did write me a letter and said that they did not send out any tampered video or edited video, that the only two people who could have done that, who had the password, were Robin O'Hara and Paul Cormier. I was recently talking to Sasha Morissette, who is the lawyer for Ambulance New Brunswick from Stuart McAlvey, and he said just the other day he has not even reviewed the video.
Yes.
Now you tell me what lawyer would not review the video, and he had one of his associates, Miss Cassidy, write the police on April the 4th asking the police for a copy of the USB stick that Robin O'Hara had given to the culprit police officer Blanchette.
Yes.
Okay. Now, when they charged me with assault and all of this, there was no pre-assessment done. They won't tell me who signed the charge sheet, who was the prosecutor who signed the charge sheet. They won't tell me that. They knew there was a report from the police of injuries of me.
Yes.
Constable Nancy Rideout reported the injuries. in her police report, and those injuries were never dealt with.
Yes.
It's my understanding that if a police officer injures somebody, then there's supposed to be another type of investigation.
Yes.
There was none of that. It's bogus. So, anyway, on top of all of that, the police investigated themselves, as I said.
Yes.
I wrote complaints about the four officers. The four officers, the chief said it was a frivolous complaint, and he sent it on to the NB Police Commission, to Pierre Boudouin and Peter Schultz.
Yes.
And they said that they agreed with him, don't bother getting the CC, you know, don't bother getting a third party involved or anything to investigate the corrupt police.
Right? Yes.
So anyway, I wrote the police commission and I said, I have this CCTV evidence and I have got more than one expert now saying that it has been badly edited. There's splitting on there that occurs. It's a motion censored camera, and yet it is, there's no pictures of me, the main character, supposedly, coming into the paramedic bay or leaving it. And what Robin O'Hara did was he included a couple of pictures of me from months ago or a year ago when I dropped something off there to make it look like I had been there longer that day.
Yes.
You know? And the Crown accepted that. How could the Crown, how could the judges accept this stuff that is not even common sense? It defies logic.
Yes.
Simple logic. There's just no way. And in one picture, there was a police officer appeared on the video out of nowhere. And why would you send a fleet of four police cars to Ambulance New Brunswick for a woman who has no criminal record, no criminal past, has never had any violence issues, and you've got four police officers coming there, and it was staged. You could tell it was staged. They knew in advance that I was coming. And this is why I want to go further and tell you why there's more to the story than just me going there and so forth. Because I uncovered another major fraud crime, and I want to talk about that a bit.
Okay.
But I want to show you, with me with the heart defibrillator, I want to show you the pictures of my bruises.
Yes.
Which the police commission even, you know, like a woman with a heart defibrillator, the first thing a paramedic is supposed to do is to do vitals.
Yes.
Okay, I asked for them to take my blood pressure. I have evidence which I gave the judge this morning, who was before the court this morning. He got it over 2 weeks ago. I asked him this morning, did you read the motion and the affidavit? He said yes. And I said, you didn't see anywhere in there where it talks about Stitchcomb, O'Connor, and McNeil, and the fact that you don't give disclosure on the date of the trial.
Did he actually deny your disclosure today?
Yes.
Wow.
He's denied it, yes. And they, and here's some more pictures of my bruises. And you see my lifeline bracelet?
Yes.
That I had on that day?
Yes.
And my puffers were, this is pictures of my arms.
Yes.
And then the police did take pictures of my wrists that obviously were doctored, because my family doctor saw them within a couple of days, and she noted the bruises. I had a lump about the size of half an egg on my wrist.
Yes.
Okay? It was really bad. And I have soft tissue injury in this finger.
Yes.
And still today, this swells up here.
People don't realize when they're arrested by the police that the police often use what's called pain compliance, when in a different day that would be called torture. But when the police do it, it's called pain compliance. And there's
not only that, I was sick. My download of my defibrillator, my doctor and his staff in October, when they downloaded it, they said, this is consistent with getting beaten up.
Yes.
I have a witness for that, you know?
Yes.
And here I am getting beaten up, and this defibrillator, you're supposed to avoid all rough contact.
Yes.
You know, and things like that. I'm not here to feel sorry for myself, okay?
Yes.
I have cataracts, I have hypoglycemia, I got everything. And I'm not here to cry for my health, but I'm here to say, I'm lucky I'm alive after being thrown around by the cops, and then for them to doctor the CCTV videos to edit it so grossly is unthinkable.
Yes.
And NCI in Ontario said too, we should get the original, because they know it's not the original.
Yes.
And I put the police and Atlantic Alarm and Sound and Ambulance New Brunswick on notice that this was a criminal case, not to do anything to the original version.
Yes.
Okay. It's a court matter. So anyway, what I also wanted to say was, this is, I was trying to find out if Ambulance New Brunswick at 24 Herald Dottery Court is a Crown Corporation.
Yes.
So nobody was able to tell me, and I went to the building across the street, right over there. See, it's called Service New Brunswick.
Yes.
Over there. And I went in there. I was told to go from one office to another. I spent about 2 hours there. And then finally, I went up to births and registrations, and I said to the boss up there, I said, please come downstairs with me, because they won't show me where the corporate records are.
Yes.
Okay? So he came down, and then the girl showed me, and I was introduced to Miss Susan Baker, who is the manager of corporate records. So anyway, I got started there with looking up documents for Ambulance New Brunswick.
Yes.
Okay. Then I found out the Ambulance New Brunswick is incorporated as a Crown company, which is a public company.
Yes.
So therefore it gets money from tax benefits, it gets money from donations and various other places. But then I found out that Ambulance New Brunswick Inc. is also illegally incorporated under the Companies Act.
Yes.
By letters patent. Okay?
Yes.
And that is a no-no. And this is the corporate records from the corporate registry.
Yes.
Of Ambulance New Brunswick Inc.
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
And I'm going to be giving you these documents to put on your blog.
Okay.
And in this document, guess who is on the board of Ambulance New Brunswick Inc.? We've got Thomas Maston from the Department of Health.
Yes.
He was a director at one time. We've got Charles Murray.
Yes.
And we've got Donald Peters. That
yes.
is a major conflict, because when all this stuff happened to me and I was writing the Minister of Health about what happened to me, there was no investigation done.
Yes.
None. And these people are on the board of Ambulance New Brunswick.
Yes.
And that should not ever have been allowed, you know?
Yes.
Because for one thing, the paramedics are under the Paramedic Act, okay?
Yes.
And the paramedics, I had written a complaint about this Dennis Boyce and the pill popping and so forth. And the registrar of the paramedics, who is there, that organization is also represented by Stuart McKelvey.
Yes.
Stuart McKelvey represents the paramedics, the Nurses Association of New Brunswick, the Irvings, the certain of the hospitals in New Brunswick, including Chalmers Regional Health Authority B. Cox and Palmer represent the Regional Health Authority B, and Stuart McKelvey does represent some of the hospitals.
Yes.
But the Paramedic Association and the Nurses Association is definitely represented by Fred McKelman of Stuart McKelvey.
Yes.
And Ambulance New Brunswick, Inc. is represented by Sasha Morissette from Stuart McKelvey as well.
Yes.
Now what I want to say, go back, is Ambulance New Brunswick, Inc. Letters Patton.
Yes.
And actually, some people probably think corporate information is complex.
Yes.
And some of it is a wee bit, but it's easy to understand once you start looking at the documents. And what happened was, in June 6, 2007, Pam Mitchell, who was then Assistant Deputy Minister of Health, Byron Smith and Wayne Buffett were the initial directors.
Yes.
Of the company staff. And this was only in place for about a month until they changed directors.
Yes.
Okay? They changed the directors. And they came up with the idea of incorporating a company called New Brunswick EMS Inc. Okay?
Yes.
And in order to do that, they had to file a notice with Service New Brunswick in order to use New Brunswick in a name.
Yes.
And this is very, very important because I want to make sure I present this today.
Yes.
Because in those articles, what they did was
So what we'll do is we'll pick this up in video part three.
Okay.
So we'll leave it right there for now.
Okay.
And we'll continue. We'll let you find the paper and start on number three.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, Evelyn, for sharing this information with us.
You're very welcome.
We appreciate it, and we'll continue in part three.
Stay tuned because there's Irving corruption coming up.
That's a great cliffhanger. Thank you.